In the afternoon session, we will focus now on the media freedom situation and developments with the media regulation and political control over the media in Croatia and Slovenia. And we'll have all the time in mind what we said about the situation in Hungary, and we'll see if there are similarities or differences and what we can conclude on that. So we have a new group of speakers. Mitja, will I introduce them? We suggest that we start with Croatia. So we had Hungary, Croatia, and at the end we will have our hosting country, our country Slovenia, to see about the similarities or differences. Mitja, will you introduce our speakers?
Well, yes. Our speakers from Croatia are Zdenko Duka, who is the president of Croatian Association of Journalists, and Gordana Vilović, professor of the Faculty of Political Sciences at the University of Zagreb. And then we have Grega Repoš, president of Slovenian Association of Journalists and editor of Mladina Weekly, Professor Marko Milosavljević, professor of the Faculty of Social Sciences at the University of Ljubljana, Vojko Stopar, director of Directorate of for the Media within the Ministry of Culture of the Republic of Slovenia. So this is the panel here, and I would really suggest that we start with Croatian case, and then we'll go on and we'll spread the problems down to Slovenia as well.
So this time we have one more speaker, so a bit more crowded among us. And keep in mind, we want you to participate this time more than in the first session. So let's start to see. In Croatia, there have been for almost years, and especially in last period, quite some disputes over the governmental role in the media, various monopolies and interference. Please, then.
We also had a mission in January, SIMO mission in Zagreb.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So, several words at the beginning on the media landscape in Croatia. It is a bad economic situation in Croatia, so it's bad economic situation in Croatian media too. Newspapers circulations are going down, advertising diminished for at least 40%. Many part-time employed journalists were fired, about 250 at public television and radio, at HRT, but also in press, in Europa Press Holding, Štirija, Vjesnik and Novi List, and almost every media cutting down salaries and other expenses. So after many years, we had first journalist strikes. Last year in spring, we had the strike in Glas Istre Daily in Pula because of canceling of collective agreement and cutting down salaries about 30-40%. Court in Pula decided that canceling agreement was illegal, but just now nothing really happened after that. We had also at the end of last year strike on Zagreb Radio 101, very famous radio station, which gathered about 100,000 people at Zagreb main square in the year 1996. And now Radio 101 has gone, is in bankruptcy, but with a real good chance now to be sold. At the time, it is the seventh day of strike in Večernji list, very influential daily Styria owns Večernji list and 24 sata. Večernji list is the second circulated daily in Croatia. Collective agreement is a reason. Collective agreement expired and Večernji list management set up rules on work, so suspended collective agreement. And now about 80% of regular employees are on strike, but Večernji list is published because of partly employed journalists. They do this work. Croatian journalist doesn't have a national collective agreement. But first, because of strike in Večernji list, Croatian Journalist Association and Trade Union of Journalists gathered about 500 journalists last Friday who protested in front of Večernji list premises. It was strike of solidarity in many, many Croatian press rooms. this strike was supported by working councils of Styria in Austria and also International Federation and European Federation of Journalists did it also. Now our trade union and publishers are at the end of negotiation process, and we will see what will be, because deadline for these negotiations for national collective agreement expires soon, and it's possible decision on a journalist general strike. We will see what will be on it. When we talk about Croatian media generally, sensationalism grows. Owners wrongly believe that Yellow Press will stabilize their circulation numbers. Croatia is the small market, and we have two attitudes combined, serious, entertaining newspapers in one. Dailies are more and more similar to one another, and judging by format, graphics, and even general orientation, dailies in Croatia are mostly tabloids. And social and public role of journalism becomes less and less important, while the run for profit becomes the main motive. But there is some optimistic pulls. Also, some pulls show media credibility is on rise lately. Media disclosed and covered many corruptive scandals. For several last years, not only these 2 years ago, because you know when Sanader, Croatian Prime Minister, resignate, it was in July 2009. After that, many corruptive scandals opened, and state attorney office started to work well on these corruptive cases. politics retain direct influence in state and public media. It is there, especially in HINA news agency, which is half money state owned, and Vjesnik daily, but also in Croatian public television. And also in local media, where journalists have traditionally suffered the pressure from local rulers. Political influence in private media has become more sophisticated. Lately, media owners are in kind of deal with especially ruling politicians, as well as with big corporations. At public HRT is bad situation. HRT has had the acting management and editors in chief for 18 months. Now, at the end of last year, December, Parliament accepted new law on public radio television. With the new body also, supervising committee, as well as a program council, and now is procedure of appointing new management and after that new editors in chief. It was political appointment agreed by position and opposition in parliament, according to this law on Croatian television. Non-profit institutions and civil society were totally abandoned from this
process.
Yes, because ruling coalition is rather weak. Political control on HRT in this election year is weaker. Editors and the journalists mainly don't want to be hostages of HDZ and other ruling parties. Many shows cut down. Latinica, very famous show of Denis Latin, which was shutting down after 17 years for political reasons. Now we have a situation that 180 journalists in HRT news program sign initiative for public television. They are unsatisfied with their position and concerned about the future of this public television. Ministry of Justice working group intended to install possible prison penalty for libel. I have to say that it was abolished from penal code in year 2006. And after the pressure of our association and the European Federation of Journalists, OSCD, and others, also the President of the Republic, Ministry dropped that prison penalty proposal. We, Croatian Journalists Association, with Konrad Adenauer Stiftung, want to set up a working group for tripartite media council, which will consist of journalists, publishers, and representatives of public as self-regulatory body. Publishers also now accept this idea, and the main problem is to establish this council will be to find out the way of financing it. And CJA also proposed changes in media law. Working group for media law has not been established yet in the Ministry of Culture, He proposed changes to give journalists more influence over the editorial policy and on appointing and dismissals of editors in chief. And in this proposed changes, we also demanded ownership transparency.
Okay.
So, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Zdenko. So what we can summarize, it's the continuous problems on labor relations or social position of journalists, but very much in connected with political pressure and now the request to revise media regulation to empower role of journalists in the sense of providing independence of the media. Gordana, what you have to add about the Croatian situation?
Not too much, because Zdenko Duka gave everything important in Croatian media today. I will say a few things, and I will start with quote made by Remzi Lani. Remzi Lani is an Albanian media expert, and I think that something he put into his newest text is something that we can also say for Croatia, maybe Slovenia, but I will try to read it carefully so that you will understand, because I do not have, as Zdenko, this PowerPoint. This is a quote. The media in the region are not any more longer with government pressure to the extent that they were up until a few years ago. Now, media face capitalistic trends and financial pressures such as foreign capital, distribution, transparency, ownership, labor policy and corruption. Hence, a media proletariat, I don't know exact pronunciation in English, but I think that media proletariat is really a good word for explaining in which condition many, many journalists from Croatia are now living, is now a new emerging phenomenon in the many Balkanian countries. Nowadays, bosses and editors pose more of a direct or immediate threat to journalists than governments do. Hot issues in the region are now focused on relations between media organizations and their employees, the labor market, professional unions and media ownership. And this is the end of the quote, and Remzi Lani mentioned demokratura instead of democracy. I would not say that in Croatia is that, but if you are comparing some situation that foreign capital media brought into our country, then you will see that they had really different measures, for example, Austria, Germany, and what they are doing in our countries. I would not say that this is colonialization. But I'm sorry, I must mention this here. And also, at the end of the first part of the round table, someone said, what is the influence of Hungarian story to neighboring countries? I would say Facebook, because in the last 1.5 months in Croatia, twice a week, a group started with Facebook is having a walk around the city, and actually I don't like when they are staying in front of homes of politicians and when they are making noisy to families, but I like when the Face group visited Croatian public service or Croatian television. I like when they visited also Europa Press Holding, the biggest private company which is shared with VATS. And I also like when they gave support to Vecini list people who are still in strike. So for me, this part is very important, and we can read that people need media, free media. They understand how it is important to have pure information, just pure information. But very often, some state media, especially Croatian television, is trying to give a better picture than it is now in our country. And also, I want to add that recently one research was published about trust into institutions in Croatia, and people in Croatia, according to that research made by professors of law faculty, said that those who participated in research had more trust into media, especially in television and print media. And on the other side, the Croatian Catholic Church lost a lot from the research in 2004. I believe in research, but I am sure that many, many young people do not read print media. They are reading online media. They are young, new generation of readers, and they are mostly reading papers in cafes, but not buying. And that's the reason why I'm reservirana.
Detached.
Okay, about that, but. All online media and internet are giving a more pluralism than it was before. And I have also to say one story, very crazy story about radio stations in Zagreb. There are no more local radio stations that are producing own news. They are having one like a company producer of news, and they are delivering to all local small stations, not only in Zagreb, but all around the Croatia. And what is terrible, they are saying them what kind of music they have to play. And when you are, for example, working through Zagreb and entering to shops, you starting with antenna, the most popular, and in another shop is also antenna, the third shop is antenna, all around is antenna radio, local radio is following you. I mean, it is also a matter of profit. It is only money, nothing else. They do not care about news, about the main role of media.
What about this EU membership? So now you are to close your negotiation, Croatia, your country.
Yes.
And then you are seeing developments in EU member countries like Hungary. How much it influence your debate on media freedom and fight of your journalists there?
I think that when I was thinking how to start my presentation
discussion.
Yes, I said I will start with the word the media situation in Croatia at the moment is turbulent, because I think it's the best way how I will describe. I think that at the moment Croatian Journalist Association is organization that is trying, you know, to say in public about the problem on media laws and everything, but I'm not sure that this is something that is
heard.
Yes.
There was something behind your quoting Ramzi when he was talking about not only
demokratura,
but when he was talking about editors.
Yes.
And I understood that he meant that the editors are the main villains.
Yes.
In media sphere.
But it is. I know Ramzi and he's.
No, but she did it on purpose.
But I want to say that probably, and he has, and you have in mind. These are the executors of this whole ideology.
Yes. Yes.
Of this whole transition ideology. And it seems just that they are powerful, but they are often change themselves, but they think they are powerful. Okay.
I hope that I was clear.
Yes, you were. It was like a story, a rabbi and two witnesses, you know.
Yes, Andres.
You were right. Well, I think that it would be interesting now to hear some views on the situation, media situation in Slovenia. And since we gave the first word to the president of Croatian Association of Journalists, now I should give the word to the president of Slovenian Association of Journalists and the editor of Mladina, Gregor Repovš.
Thank you, Mitja. Yes, today listening to our colleagues from Hungary, it brought bad memories to me, to the time of our ex-government and ex-prime minister. And what I thought when listening to what's happening to Hungary from you was, okay, you are in 2005. So we got that government in 2004. And what are you saying now and talking about and your stories? It's the good time, you know. This is still the good time of the political pressures. It's the start. And when were we in 2005, we had a new law about public TV, a new law about media, and our colleague from RAI came to Ljubljana, and we were preparing to referendum. It was really a time when it seems that it will be hard, but we will win. It's logical that we will win, we said. It was the logic of human rights, of free press, of everything was, we thought, on our side. But the truth is that it was the first year, and it lasted 3 years and a half till all community, journalist community, woke up totally, bringing up a petition and then making a public strike, not strike in a union way, but that this must stop. And we went through all those periods, all those laws, all those things which were, yesterday it was a joke in a cafe, and next day it was reality, you know. It was happening all the time. One day we were joking that we will have, I don't know, a guy for a director of public TV, and next day it was true. It was like nightmare, you know. So we went all through that, but after 4 years we got this new government, left government, which is scared, which is again scared from journalists, from public, from opposition, and trying to do something, listening to us, trying to listen also to the publishers. And we are waiting for this law. I'm not saying that they are not trying to do a good law, but they are all lobbyists, and you know how all lobbyists works. So, but what we lost in those 4 years is the most important part of this. We had this government, we had this fight, and we actually, on the end, we won. We won, we convinced the public that media freedom and press freedom and free speech, that those are important topics. But in 4 years we lost a lot, because after 4 years of fight we were, journalism in Slovenia was wounded, and it's still wounded now. And 4 years after this battle for free speech, we lost first 4 years of development. In all this time, we were battling for I would say, things which supposed to be here when you work, and we lost the battle with a technology era in all Slovenian media. We still don't have good owners knowing what to do with media and what medias are. We came to crisis with all those problems from this period. We have changes made by internet with all those changes which are technological. So in 4 years, we actually lost a possibility to run in this game, which is on the end a business game. So what we have now, we didn't fight with normal problems. We were not thinking what were our colleagues in Guardian, for example, how we will battle for our readers in this era of new technology. We are talking about things which are so normal if you work as a journalist. So this is what we have now. We have media landscape which is totally ruined, and we have so many people trying to rebuild to normality, but not the normality which should be in 2011, but the normality which should be in 2005. And what are our colleagues in Croatia saying is the same. They are talking about the things which should be here when we start working. It's like a pencil. It's like a computer. And this is the biggest problem. But it's not problem just for journalism. It's problem for the public, because journalism, which is dealing with those problems, and journalists which are dealing with those problems, starting with collective agreement, they can't think about the future of the of the future for the nation, for people, about ecology, about development, about education, about all the things which should be in a society important. So that's the biggest problem which you have after a battle like our colleagues in Hungary are going through, which, as we are reading, is going on through constitution and so on, what's happening now. So this is what's the biggest loss, is the loss for the society.
Thank but you. Grega, just a few more sentences. Our audience probably expect you can add it later, but now two sentences. The Slovenian media freedom situation now. Okay, we have left center government, but there are also claims in this index that press freedom in Slovenia is declining. And then this initiative around Europe, should we have regulation on European level? 2-3 sentences, please.
Yes, of course, Sandra is right. Our biggest problem now is, as I said, we have a lack of rights, of workers' rights in journalism. I would agree with saying that this is a media proletariat. This is one of the biggest problems. And the second problem, talking about the free speech, is that we, as I said already, we don't have ownership of media, which would be, the biggest owner of media in Slovenia is a brewery, which is trying to sell all those medias owned by this brewery. They bought all those media in the time of last government to convince the government that they could buy another company. You know, everything is ruined. So everything is so crazy. I don't want to repeat all those stories, but the biggest problem is you don't have normal ownership structure, which was bad before and ruined that in that period. You don't have normal organizations of journalists in media. you don't in that period it was very bad period and hard period for association and for unions all over the media. So everything is ruined and you are starting and the technology process is going on all the time. We are trying to get to this train which already left in if I use this sentence in 2008.
Grega was talking about wounded journalism, about ruined journalism in Slovenia as a consequence of the doings of previous government and so. Now, Vojko Stopar, you are now director of Directorate of Ministry of Culture in the new government. How is your government dealing with this wounded journalism?
The best possible way, of course.
Which means what?
We are still working on the first
round. Killing.
I think it's a plead.
I would like to apologize the organizers of this round table because of these empty seats, and I think I'm responsible for that because we just launched new mass media law in the governmental procedure yesterday, so everybody, all media people are at home and studying this draft media law, I suppose. And another memory, being, let's say, media regulator, okay, I always remember of Mr. Marshall being editor-in-chief of our central daily newspaper, and he made a commercial for his newspaper. He was walking on the roof of
his building,
editorial building, and he said, "We are always at the edge." So I would say I am always on the razor blade, and this is the proof. Okay, it was very, very difficult over last 2 years to prepare a draft media law and to mind all the troubles, all the bad situation in media happening these days. More or less, I think, in my opinion, because of economical reason, not so much as political, but economical reason. And there two approaches emerged. And one side, a very liberal, and we had many discussions, roundtables in preparing this law. And let's say the owners, the editors-in-chief, they were all on the side of liberal approach. Self-regulation, co-regulation, as less as possible regulation by law. And on the other hand, there were civil society groups, including journalist associations, journalist syndicate, and let's say Peace Institute, and many others, who were supporting a stronger regulation, a stronger law with some guarantees for, let's say, editorial freedom, guarantees for independence, autonomy. And the problem was that these two sides never want to speak to each other. One side spoke to us, and the other side came to us and speak to us. But they didn't want to talk between them. I don't know why. And I think that's maybe an indicator of the situation in media today. And it supports my thinking that there is a capital on the one side, and then there are journalists and freedom of press on the other side. And they don't talk. I don't know why. They talk via Ministry of Culture as a governmental institute preparing a new media law. And it was really, really very difficult over those 2 years to find a way between those two approaches. As I said, liberal one or I can't say conservative, but let's say the movement for stronger regulation. I hope we succeeded in some way, especially Mr. Duca said about more transparent ownership. We hope we have now some articles that will, let's say, a little bit clarify the situation. And on the other hand, we have a strong institute supporting journalist autonomy in now in this premises. They have a strong influence in appointing the editor in chief.
In what way?
They can, first of all, they must be asked. They must be asked for their opinion about the editor-in-chief who
is to be nominated.
And if they don't agree, they can propose their own candidate to the owner. Mm-hmm. And after 2 months, the owner, if there is no if there is no agreement from the editorial staff for the some candidate, they must get the
consent
from the owner. It's not, let's say, absolute guarantee, but at least the management have to take a discussion with editorial staff, and it must last at least 2 months. And I think every smart management will take care, will take in mind, will bear in mind the opinion of the journalists.
Bojko,
yes.
Two small questions. The last attempt from your government to regulate something in the media field was very much opposed by the opposition. So we, the citizens, went on referendum on public service broadcasting regulation last December. Okay. Do you think whatever you would make put in that law would have the same reaction? So there is no possibility for political consensus in this country on media regulation, or it is wrong approach? And with that is connected the question, do you expect that the opposition will put this new media regulation you are describing on referendum again? And second, small, so why do you don't make efforts to achieve political consensus with the opposition? And the second one is, what do you think about European directive on media freedom? Is it necessary?
First of all, we lost the referendum for new broadcasting law, not because of the law, but because of the political situation in the country. Any law proposed by government and that would force to go to a referendum could lose in that time. And if the situation remains the same, it is possible. It is possible that also this mass media law will be put on a referendum, and who knows what will happen then.
European regulation,
I'm afraid I must agree with Sandra. The European media regulation is more or less, let's say, media economist regulation. Because only articles with some economic inflation came through. There is nothing in European, I mean European Commission regulation that will go along with media freedom, journalists' independence, and so on and so on. There are always only decisions about economical background, not with, let's say, freedom of the press.
But would you support one? As a
it can't do no harm.
Okay. Thank you, Marko Milosavljević. You have to be the last one at this panel, so to conclude, having some university position to have a broader view on this. So let me ask you, when I was reviewing what is the problem with Hungarian law, so and even in the analysis by European institutions, they're claiming the specificity of requests for balanced reporting, uravnoteženo poročanje. We all know, so it is now in European documents on Hungary, but we in Slovenia very much know what is this about, because the previous government insisted to put this in the law.
And it came from the mouth of European member of parliament who is coming from this.
From Slovenia,
yeah.
So balanced reporting. Then we have no discussion before the law was submitted. So we remember April 2005, that the law was just appeared in the parliament, and it happened to Hungary again. Okay, so, and then we have this media authority, media council, and the president have huge power. Okay, it's not comparable to our APEC. There, but the authority president there is appointed by prime minister. Our APEC director is appointed by the government. Not forget it. There are some similarities, pretty awful. With the registration, media register. Everybody in Europe is like saying, what is this about? In Slovenia, we have media registers for a year. It is not misused by any government so far. But we have any media before starting have to register to the Ministry of Culture. So we have some similarities, but mm-hmm. still have some, at this moment, less of such problems that is now producing such a reaction in Europe. What would you say about this comparison between the situation in Hungary and Slovenia, and then you can continue on this European reaction? Is it something that will be productive, bring something or not?
Well, yes, regarding the comparison between Hungary and Slovenia, I must return back to what the colleague from Hungarian public radio said about his downloading the law and how his computer was stuck because I guess the file was so huge. Well, we had a similar reaction to that law, only in the aspect that the law was actually presented to the public on Friday afternoon, and it was the 1st of April. So when we saw that law, I know that a lot of people thought that it's a fool's day joke. That's how it sounded. It sounded archaic. Especially the right to correction, a number of other provisions which we couldn't find in any sort of comparable European regulation, but not just European on the transnational level, but within the European countries, or for example, comparable countries like United States, Canada, or other countries. A number of other things that made us thought that actually this is a joke. Now the thought, or I would say the philosophy that I guess led to that sort of law showed up in a number of occasions. I will quote only two which really stuck in my mind, and after that I really stopped trying or stopped attempting to understand how this law came about. The first occasion was the discussion that we had, a public discussion at the Agency for Post and Electronic Communication. It was the discussion on the European Audiovisual Media Service Directive. Now, this is the directive that is, as Mr. Vojko Stoper said, it's almost exclusively economic. It deals with the product placements, it deals with new media, it deals with the question of social networks and so on and so on. And there were a number of representatives from telecommunication companies, from mobile phone operators and so on, all eager to actually find out what they will be able to do with their content and what not. And there were a few of us discussing this directive, and one of the members started saying, first we must deal with the socialism. The socialism is the main issue of Slovenia. We must once for all finish with this communism and so on and so on. And I was waiting a few minutes, but then I couldn't wait any more longer, and I said, okay, can we please talk about Audiovisual Media Service Directive? We are here for this sort of discussion. I really can't find any connection between product placement and the discussion about socialism and so on. And his response was, no, 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 wait a minute, we're all children of partisans or Quislings. That was one of such occasions when I stopped thinking about how I could understand that sort of logic of the laws that I had in front of me. The second occasion was actually the statement made by one of the members of the Programming Council of Public Broadcaster, who was appointed in 2006 after the new law on public broadcasting was passed. And this member of Programming Council, at one of their sessions, said officially, he said that all rock and jazz music should be withdrawn from the programs of public broadcaster, because it is well known from scientific research that even the cows give less milk when they're forced to listen to rock and jazz music. After these two statements, I stopped attempting to understand the logic of that sort of thing. In my opinion, it's archaic, and I really actually don't want to deal with these sort of things. I would like to refer back to not just to the Hungarian situation, but also to the Slovenian situation. And Gregor Polš said that we are that the journalists are wounded by the battles that they fought for the last 4 or 5 years. But I would say that it's not just the politics that had caused this wound to the journalists. I think that economy has a great deal to do with this as well. Sandra said that no media has been closed down in the last few years. Well, actually, a number of media have been closed down. I'll just remind you about free newspapers like Dobro Jutro, like Total Tedna, sports newspaper AS, about Info TV and the financial troubles, about Showvizia, about TV Pink and its supposed news program, and so on and so on. A number of supplements were closed down. Of course, a number of new, especially magazines, were started. But it seems that the crisis has taken its toll, although not as much as probably we would hope for, because it seems, in my opinion, that if the number of media outlets would decrease, it would be better for those who would stay. Right now we have 1,500 media outlets in this country. This is a country of 2 million people, and you can imagine what this actually means for the economy and for the economic background of this media. I have here some data that I took just and since the people, my colleagues, didn't talk about this. The amount of advertising last year on Slovenian television stations has increased by 50%. That's not 15, increased. But 50.
Increased.
Has increased the amount of advertising. So that is the amount of time that we are forced to watch commercials on Slovenian televisions just in the last year. That's 50%. In the same time, some of the broadcasters have managed to actually to increase their revenue. For example, the largest commercial has increased its revenue by 8% in euros, not in dollars, but in euros, and so on. There are some optimistic...
Sorry, do you mean per minute? Increase per minute advertising?
Yes.
In total.
In total?
In total, the amount of...
Because the price
time.
Is the same.
All the... What do you mean, or which figure? You mean the 50% increase? That's the amount of time that we are watching this. The minutes, hours. In 2009, we were watching 7 hours of advertising per day on all combined Slovenian televisions. In 2010, there were 10.5 hours per day. So that's a 50% increase in the amount of advertising on that. Which means that at the same time, the revenue has not increased in the same, which means that the discounts have increased and we are forced to watch more and more of this. We have a lot of other problems as well, and they are economic, they're not just political. We have a free newspaper that is very successful with the readers, however it has accumulated more than 25%, 25 million euros of loss in the last 5 years, and every month we hear new stories, are they going to close down, are they going to continue, and so on, and the politics actually has nothing to do with this. So there is of course a combination, not just of politics, but also of economic crisis and economic situation of this particular small place that makes it harder for journalists to work in this country. And I wouldn't just talk about proletariat. We could also say we know how the castes in India work, and we could say that we have also the untouchables, but not in terms that Brian De Palma had in his movie, unfortunately. But we have untouchables, which are those in the really lowest ranks. The people, the young people who have no contracts, who have not just jobs, they don't have any contract. They don't have no security, no financial security, and they are really the ones who are taking the most of the toll and the price of this economic crisis. And this is also one of the important aspects, and I'm afraid that a lot of older colleagues are not helping them with this, not just fight, but with their, let's say, rights. They know that they are there, they know that they are working, but they are not demanding any sort of rights for them. So it's not just that sort of easy, let's say, black and white situation. In the end, I would just say that, yes, we are having a lot of politics in the media. We have, everybody is talking a lot about this. I must say that I often miss not media politics, but I miss media policy. I miss the comprehensive overview of what is happening in this country, what we need in this country. Do we
Sorry, editorial policy?
No, in general. Do we really need 60 or 70 radio stations? Do we really need, is this good? Do we really need that sort of shape of the public support or the state support for the some media, where we know that most of that money finishes in the pockets of the owners, who then go and buy new cars and so on. And in fact, nobody from the workers get any of that money, the state money, that's supposed to be the help for the pluralization and so on. So I guess there is a number of issues, and I hope we can discuss about more of that later. Thank you.
Okay. Well, Marco, thank you so much for a very illustrative presentation. And now I would like to ask maybe some other panelists to add something if you have.
I would just like to ask maybe Grega, you know, is it this what is happening in the European Parliament, especially from the side of conservative representatives of post-socialist countries, saying that regulation, even European regulation, is needed, but in a way to provide pluralism in these post-socialist European countries, because journalists are predominantly leftist, you know? What do you think about this claim? Or Marco and you said to our Hungarian colleagues, we were there, but now it's better because we can conclude like this. We have new government.
No.
Should they wait for new government?
No.
And what about this claim of leftist journalism in post-socialist countries?
Look, the first, we are waiting a new government, you know, and this is the government we just lost. You know? So we'll get Janša back. We hope not, but we expect in 2 years. So it goes around, comes around. So, yes, about this. We don't talk about left journalists. We talk about communists, because we are communists. I'm not left journalist. I'm a communist.
According to them,
I'm communist, and I was on the wrong side in the Second World War. Because they, you know. This is how they are picturing us. And this is their agenda, how they fight for in political discussions, in political arena. But the problem is, the biggest problem is that we have to discuss with them. You know, they always bring us in the ring. So on one side, politicians, and on the other side, journalists. And our problem is that, yes, it's true, left parties are saying the same. They talk the same language about free speech. So in their vision of the world, of the politics, of the society, we are all the same. Are Slovenian journalists, for example, are they left? Are they left? I wouldn't say. They are very neoliberal, you know, they are very liberal. If I look through Slovenian media landscape and watch how Slovenian media see economy, they are very conservative. So it's not true, but it's the easiest way how to exclude all people from media or the other side from the debate. As you remember, you Brankica, you were one of them, and Marco also. All the people from a university talking about journalism, they were called a quasi media experts. You know, so this was the problem. And we, as said, we were communists, and we are still. I must tell you that we are still communists, and we were on the other side.
We are facing this discourse constantly, and it is repeating in the parliament. But this is the reality. These are our co-citizens, these are our politicians, and so on. How to overcome this? How to overcome? I know what you're talking, but I would like to know how to go through this. You know, because I am pretty sure I was participating once on this type of discussion organized by, at that time, the government was in power, and by the civil society group close to them. And we were trying to discuss, there are minimum issues on which definitely we all can agree in this country, including Mr. Janša or Pahor or something, you know. And characters request Media Freedom Directive. And the conservative political groups request Media Freedom Directive, but with completely opposite arguments, because conservatives claims media are leftist, we have to bring European regulation to provide balance. And we claim we don't want politicians to control the media. And
look, when I became 10 years ago, when I became a president of the society, they said, "Okay, now we have a young journalist, which didn't work for the media in the socialism time, and it will be easier." But I became a communist in 2 months. So I don't know. I don't have a solution. I think that I'm waiting for another. Who will come? Yeah,
I think that we are going now into the sphere which is slightly. I mean, especially when young Grega is talking about communism. All right. But nevertheless, I think that these accusations by either side, either Demokratura or either political party, is, as a professional journalist, as far as I'm concerned, it's a sort of trivial thing.
No, it's
We have been always a target of some criticism, of some accusations, and so on, and so on. No matter who is in power, who is in charge, and so on. Because we are in such a position that we are also always targeted. So, I really don't see this as a sort of major topic of our discussion. And that's why I'm opening the floor to all of you.
Yes, please help us to come out from this. Okay.
If I may.
Yes. Michal Lamprek.
Your name is?
Public Broadcasting Radio. So, if I remember quite well, in 1989, when the Berlin Wall fell down, George Conrad, the famous sociologist, said, "Now the things will become normal." 22 years after that, we all try to persuade us that things are totally abnormal. But let me, this is my personal view. On Friday, I visited Kino Dvor, on the documentary International Film Festival. I spent 3 hours documentary on Ceausescu. On Sunday, I spent 1.5 hours, it was a movie about President Tito and his personal his personal ambition to watch as much as possible movies per day. But let me clarify this. Things okay, maybe things become from bad to worse, but in these circumstances regarding what was 20, 20, 22 years ago and more, this has nothing to do with this, what we are living now. What my daughter and son, how they perceive the reality in Slovenia or in Europe. Yes, we, for example, we as public broadcasters, we do have a lot of problems, everyday problems. I have 410 employees. I have to ask every day myself, what is the need of the audience? How to share professional standards with the commercial radio station in Slovenia? We have roughly 90 commercial radio stations in Slovenia. How to deal and how to share the professional standard with commercials also? What is the what means Slovenia media landscape? What means relating to the incomes of GDP in Slovenia terms of economy? So, but I still believe in public broadcasters, despite the fact we have to earn our money on the basic of license fee paying system. Yeah. And there are what is very bad for us and for my colleagues. And also for the colleagues which we do not share, let's say, some professional status or ideas or the basic, how to say, Maginot line is ideological line in Slovenia journalism. But this is reality. But we have to as a public broadcaster, we have to serve different audiences. And I still believe that we produce what the others cannot and do not want to produce as a commercial. And for example, we do have similar problems as the other members of the European Broadcasting Union do have, especially this part of former Yugoslavia, Southeastern Europe, etc., etc. But things are not so this is not so as it was before. So I took these descriptions very conditionally regarding the battle between left and right, communist and so-called expert, and so, et cetera, et cetera. The damage to the whole society is that every 4 years, when the new government is coming, yeah, left to the center, right to the center, we have to accept the new media law, the new law of RTV, and this is very bad for us. But I still believe that there are specific journalists, and there is specific journalism in the field of culture, in the field of domestic film production, concert production. I know we have to improve ourselves on the field of information system, as we as public broadcasters. But people still believe, we still have a sort of credibility among the audience, and this is very important.
Mika, one question. One question. Do you see anything in the claim of Gregor Repauš that 4 years are lost of the previous government for this media? I will continue because you were the director of Radio Slovenia, and then the new government came, new law. And you were replaced. Now you are again. Do you consider that period as a lost period for Radio Slovenia?
Yes. this is not my personal pain. Yes.
Yes. Okay.
The state of mind and the circumstances 4 years before, or even a little bit more than 4 years, and comparing to nowadays, yes, we have to improve it together.
Okay.
For the benefit of the audience. And for the benefit of the people who are still believe in public broadcast and who are still working on public radio.
It is still the first radio according to audience measure in our country. Gordana, you want?
Yes, I just wanted to say that I totally agree with you about public radio. The same is in Croatia. And very often when we are speaking about public service, then we are saying that we are not satisfied and thinking about television, but public radio in Croatia, I hope Zdenko will support my opinion, is still something that is totally different from all other radio stations. But I'm 54 years old and I'm listening always public radio in Croatia. I'm afraid that there are a lot of young people that do not care about that. That's the first. And the second, I agree also with you that we are living now 22 years after Berlin Wall fall. But still, I mean, it is in our nature. We shall never be, I mean, we are always unhappy with what we have. So we are always trying to have better media. But unfortunately, I must say that the situation all around is not so good. Even in Western countries, the situation is bad. But in our transition, second transition, third transition, I don't know, at the moment is really terrible, and we have to fight again to reach some more freedoms. And but I need also to stress that we need responsible journalists.
Well, Sandor, Attila, now when you heard what's going on in your neighboring countries, do you feel more relaxed about the situation in Hungary?
It sounds very, very, very familiar. You see, one specific thing in Hungary that this government has such an incredible support.
It's the same.
So,
So Sandor is saying 2/3 majority of leading party is something.
And what is happening in Hungary is just part of a bigger package to reduce the checks and balances of the democratic system, cutting back the confidence of the population, or putting loyal people to key positions. So I don't exactly know where this will exactly lead. But what I
putting out, loyal people, it's, I think we know about all about it, you know, it's not so much different, but I can imagine because of this so big support on the elections, which come to the point when in this country also, when especially conservatives, when they win, they say, we won the election, so we run this country, so we will decide what will be and who will be there.
And also, what is just said, that there will be a new constitution in Hungary, but the parties, the two democratic parties of the opposition are not participating in a debate about the new constitution, and the new constitution will be most likely adopted by Easter. So there are strange things going on, and you know, Attila used to interview a very good social political scientist every Monday on Hungarian radio, whom you cannot hear anymore, and he said that this country has been living in a cold civil war, and this is
cold civil war.
This cold civil war has been going on in Hungary for 8 years, and this is the outcome of this cold civil war. And I don't know to what extent Hungary can be quoted. It seems that we are moving to a democracy, and I don't know where it will. I think it's an exaggeration. Where it will end, and how difficult it will be to get back to normal. So I have some major concerns. But many things sounded very, very similar. This labeling your opponent and considering as an enemy and things like that, and that is very common.
So,
any other comment, please?
10 more minutes, please. Take discussion. I see many, many relevant colleagues.
Well, I see also some diplomats here. Maybe we won't learn anything from them right now. Maybe we'll get some from WikiLeaks later on. I'm not sure.
I'm here just for 6 months, but reading a bit, it can seem shouldn't have big problems. I mean, you see articles every day criticizing the government from every angle. So that's why I was interested to come here, because from a very superficial point of view, as someone that just arrived, it seems that it's a very vibrant country that has a lot of debate, and that, you know, there's no one imposing what to write and how to write it.
Thank you.
Are you allowed to comment your own country? Probably not. I am tempting to ask.
Yes, please.
Yes, I'm Shvira from Association of Journalists. I just wanted to point out what Vojko Stupar said, that there, as he saw it in this debate over the media law, that there is no talk between the owners and the journalists. And I think this is really a big problem in Slovenia for 10 years. And this is not the political problem. It's the same if the government is left or it is right, you know. And that's why we don't have a collective agreement. That's why we have so many freelancers. That's why authors' rights are not regulated as they should be. And that's also why we want, as the association, as journalists, we want the regulation in the law. Because in self-regulation, in the things that we should discuss or that we should agree in a dialogue with the owners, we in 8 years didn't come. I mean, there was no result, no success. Even now in this debate over the media law, you could see that we want, I don't know, to have a bigger word in appointing the chief editor, and the owners immediately said, What are you expecting? We are investing money, we are responsible, we are not in a socialism. Why should you have a word over that? So they didn't agree on one single thing that we suggested. And I think this is really, really a big problem. And the dialogue is really not here. And now we hope that maybe the law, if it will be adopted ever, will help. But we are not certain. I mean, and if, for example, Pop TV, they have profit, mm-hmm. more profit than Marco said than yeah. last year. But I talked to editor. Of their news program, and she said that they are lack of staff, that journalists are underpaid, that she can't get new people, so they are having the same problems as any other media, even though they have profit.
And she'll be fired in the evening.
I mean, it's really complicated. Position or these two points or two really, really distant poses, yes, from the owners or the executive.
And Spela, you are participating in International Federation of Journalists meeting. Is this lack of culture, of dialogue between publishers and employers in media and journalists, is it common for whole Europe, or it is the Eastern European problem?
It's more the Eastern
Europe. And then we are those who request more regulation.
Yeah, it's more, you know, the owners in Eastern Europe are more arrogant, they have lack of culture, they don't understand the industry, they don't understand the media. So this is the problem, but also in Western European countries, the collective agreements are not negotiated, or there are problems of all sorts of problems in terms of labor rights and so that.
Maybe to ask Attila. Attila, would you comment on this? Because you said you would like to have more self-regulation and so on.
Speaking about kind of guaranteeing territorial autonomy in the law, if I understood correctly.
You don't like it.
I can tell you that in Hungary it has never been raised. That it's considered completely the owner's decision. Right. So when we were preparing the code of ethics for the self-regulation, we put some sentences about self or about editorial autonomy in the code of self-regulation, and immediately the owners jumped and said that no way, we would never accept even soft declaration of editorial autonomy, and even not speaking about the giving the right to the editorial room or the editorial team to decide on the editorial. And in fact, I don't believe that. Just to tell you the truth, I don't believe in this. I think this is the owner's decision to take. If they can consult the editorial team, but it's their business. I mean, I really believe in the fact that we are living in a capitalist society, and this is their business. If it doesn't work because they lose leadership, they should change. But this is I don't believe in.
Yeah, but this I have to react because they are telling us that this is capitalism. But this is the capitalism they don't have at home. So please go there, look, go to Germany. I'm always looking to Croatia, colleague, because they have so many owners from Germany, from VATS. Go to VATS and look media in at the West European countries owned by them. Look at their collective agreement. Look at their editorial statute, and you will see the rights you thought that are socialists.
Yes,
so the socialism is at the West. Look at the right that Styria has in Austria's medias, and look the rights the journalists have in Croatia. This is bullshit. I'm sorry, but I have to react.
Watch your tongue.
This is not working. The socialism is at home, at Germany, in UK, in France. So this. And when they cross our borders, they start to talk about capitalism, which they don't have. So they are trying. We see those things there. But we have to react. They are presenting capitalism, which are you talking about here, but not their countries. For example, our Italian colleagues, they have 14 wages. Do you have 14 wages a year? It's a minimal, 14 wages.
Can I react?
Yes, of course.
Short replica.
So I just want to repeat that I believe in capitalism, and this is the decision of the owner, in my opinion. They can consult, but this is, in fact, their money, which they are risking. Even if I'm a journalist and I'm employed, I would like to be to get consulted, but let me finish. It's their decision. So I wouldn't like to... because what I wanted to say is that in Hungary I saw editorial teams, because there were a few exceptions, of course. According to collective agreements, editorial teams had the right to decide. And in fact, when you are these editorial teams, their decision in fact strategically ruined the newspapers. This is the Hungarian example. I can tell you an example. So. I think that this is probably a cultural, and I would repeat that this is related to cultural problems, because the journalists you are speaking about in Germany are not the same journalists in mine that people in Eastern Europe, because I think they have a different vision, they can have a different vision. About democracy. I saw bad examples of editorial decisions in strategic business-related matters in Eastern Europe, at least in Hungary. So I don't believe in this. But of course, what I would like to emphasize is that editorial autonomy in a code of ethics is important to be guaranteed. Even consultation in personal decisions. But finally, this is the owner which has to take this decision. I believe in this.
Okay.
Oliver?
Just very short, I would just say, on my point of view, I'm missing one thing, and that's solidarity. Solidarity between journalists in the economic level, and also in the case when journalists are attacked. And that's the problem for us in Southeast and Central Europe. Mm-hmm. Starting from Hungary till the South, that the problem is also when journalists are attacked physically or there are some threats. They are missing solidarity from their colleagues. And the same is, I think, also in the economic level. Very often they are missing this solidarity. And this is, I think, sometimes stronger in the, say, capitalism, where we have stronger this solidarity than in the former socialist or communist country. But it's strange for me, because I think the solidarity is logical to have in this country than in the capitalism, but in the fact, it's the opposite.
We are in the first grade of capitalism.
We should conclude slowly. So I just want to make one reference on self-regulation. Attila said cultural differences. Do you know that there is an association of self-regulatory bodies in the media, informal one, of press council in Europe, having meetings every year? And there are Danish and Luxembourg press councils, developed Western countries, but the president of self-regulatory body is appointed by the Minister of Justice. And nobody sees problem in that. This is respected self-regulatory body judging on ethics, but and everybody recognizes, and minister doesn't interfere. So there is mixture of solutions around Europe on regulation, self-regulation of this media business and media operations. And what we can conclude, let's follow, especially our Hungarian colleagues now need some support, solidarity, and our eye to watch what is going on and how we can support it. But all what we can do more, maybe should we join to this European initiative led by leftist European political groups on European directive? Let's debate on it. Let at least go there and discuss and see what is about it. What else we can do? Let's maybe support each other and meet maybe more often on this regional level, on this topic. There was a media monitoring tool developed by the European Commission. Sandra was part of it together with me and Sam. So there is media pluralism monitor developed by the European Commission with purpose to, for each country to produce a report based on the same methodology about how much the media in the member countries are plural, independent, but no application of that tool because the industry stopped it. The Commission promoted it. We were there, people who were part of it, huge group of researchers, and they requested Italian media set and other groups to stop it, and it is never applied. So before maybe saying let's have European law, maybe first to have some reports or something to see what is there, maybe we can, say that this is necessary. Yeah.
I think that this afternoon's discussion was part of this.
Yeah.
And I would practically suggest that we make a kind of summary of this discussion, and we should convey this summary to this parliamentary session, which is going to be in 2 days' time in the European Parliament. And we could maybe really send a message to them.
Also, the Council of Europe Human Rights Commissioner, Mr. Hammerberg, who produced great
his report, comments on Hungarian law. Yeah.
He requested us organizers to present a summary of this discussion, and OSCE is also Dunja Mijatović asks. So we will summarize what we discussed, and also we can send to you. You provided your emails, just to keep you informed. And if any other steps will be taken by actors from Croatia, Hungary, Slovenia, we will keep you informed and invited to events, to publications, to receive from us. Is it okay?
Maybe it would be also fine. Sorry. Yeah.
Can you introduce us?
It's very important to have exchange. Regularly exchange of ongoing legislation issues, because it's like a domino system. What was happening in Janša's time with creation of APEC It was tried immediately after that in Macedonia, but it was stopped by European Union because it had the power to stop it. What is going on now in Hungary is now reflecting in Macedonia in the new broadcast law draft. They're trying to draft on the Hungarian experience. It's always the similar political orientation structure is doing it. So maybe we should collectively do the report of what is that in the populist right that is going that deeply undermining the freedom of expression in the countries where they get to the power. What's that in their ideology that is very well shared and interconnected that is undermining the journalists' liberties? We should start from that because it's obviously it's not only a technical issue, it's becoming a political ideological issue. Because the same issues are just transferring from country to the country with similar solutions.
It's very important.
Yes. Roberto Belicianest is representing media NGO from Skopje, Macedonia. Having huge disputes there about media freedom. Mm-hmm. So anybody else to help us conclude this? Or this is enough?
If you have any suggestions how to sum up this discussion today, you can email it also to...
We must show this solidarity to the colleagues, to Hungarian colleagues. It's very important.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a very important message.